Friends and colleagues, fellow scientists, I am honored to speak to you at the third conference on science for Palestine, and I wish to thank the organizers for their meticulous work and MIT for hosting such a significant event. Scientists in Palestine pursue their scholarly work amidst non-trivial contextual challenges, such as closures, travel and mobility restrictions, incursions, plus a large range of disruptive measures that create a climate of precarious uncertainty and vulnerability, that is, in addition to scarcity of resources. Over time, such measures have had their toll on higher education and scientific research. It has deprived universities from their defining feature as beacons of multicultural diversity and universality. In the 18 universities in Palestine, with a student body of over a quarter of a million students, you can hardly find any foreign student or faculty member. Besides, such measures have resulted in significant brain drain, causing a large number of Palestinian academics and technologists to reside and pursue their careers abroad. Our scientific community has navigated through such rough terrains with exemplary resilience and creativity, and has managed to remain vibrant and internationally engaged through a vigorous outreach activity, and has succeeded with minimal resources to make outstanding scientific achievements. In this context, we have worked hard to organize and consolidate science in Palestine through the formation of disciplinary and multidisciplinary scientific societies and clusters, which build the necessary critical mass to undertake effective scientific activities and to reach out to its counterparts around the world, societies in mathematics, physics, biology, chemistry, neuroscience, and nanotechnology have been established. We have also pursued the establishment of collaborative science bridges between Palestine and other countries, such as Germany, Canada, the Czech Republic, France, and Russia. These bridges have created opportunities for students and faculty mobility and exchange, collaborative research, and more. Hundreds of graduate students and scholars in science, engineering, medicine, and life sciences have benefited from these bridges. We have been reaching out to expatriate Palestinian scientists, hoping to engage them effectively in our efforts towards the advancement of learning and research in their homeland through summer and winter schools, short visits, sabbaticals, scientific consulting, and more. On the school level, we have recently launched a multifaceted STEM Palestine program in partnership with all Palestinian universities. The main purpose of the program is to cultivate critical and scientific thinking, inquiry, and discovery amongst the young. We have included STEM as one of the national priorities in our national development plan. It is noteworthy that scientific visits to Palestine by expatriate or foreign scientists have almost always had disproportionate returns, with many unintended educational and research consequences. We had visits from American, French, British, and other scientists who have made remarkable fingerprints on the state of science in Palestine. I can just name a couple: Mary Gray from the States, John Kelly from Berkeley, Sir Michael Atiyeh from the UK, and Ivar Ekeland from France, and many more. Fellow scientists, your conference takes place on the campus of the global leader of science and innovation. It is our sincere hope that your deliberations will come up with innovative ways to carve a science bridge between Palestine and fellow scientists in the United States of America, building a science bridge when other bridges are being undermined may be just the right answer. Such a bridge would be a visionary long-term investment in young talent and hope, when hope has become a scarce commodity. I wish you vibrant and challenging deliberations, and I extend to each of you an open invitation to visit Palestine. See you next summer.